So I don't have a gavel, but I would like to call the meeting to order. I know that there are some people that are still signing in, and I hope you don't mind that we start some of the administrative work while you're signing in. I appreciate you doing that. So I will call to order the City of Sammamish Planning Commission meeting on April 19th at 6:04 p.m. I'd like to start with roll call. I'll start on my left with Commissioner Collins.
Mike Collins.
You might need your mic.
Ooh, sorry.
Thank you.
Mike Collins, congratulations to the Mariners, who are currently exceeding fan expectations.
All right.
You're here.
Yeah. Brian Coleman here.
Babubul Islam.
Kathy Richardson.
Mike Luxenberg.
Joe Lipinski.
Jeff Wasserman.
Great. Thank you all. I'd like to request someone move to approve the current agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. And approval of the minutes from April 5th. Does anyone have a motion?
So moved.
Would someone second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Great. Thank you. With that, Cameron, if you would walk us through the work program calendar, that would be great.
Yes. Good evening, Madam Chair. Cameron Grohl with the Community Development Department. Appreciate everybody coming here tonight. We have two versions of calendars, and we have copies here for the public to refer to. The vertical version kind of gives you the dates for the critical areas, not including tonight, but from the next meeting on forward. Do want to remind folks that the meetings for June and July are varied from the normal first and third Thursday to the second and fourth Thursday, so please make sure to mark that on your calendar. These are the dates that we're working on right now. The other version is kind of a horizontal version. This is our typical version. And the only thing that really needs to be said there is we're not doing anything other than critical areas for the, as far as the eye can see. We'll be back to other business, I think, in the fall. Want to note for the record, too, a May 8th joint meeting with the City Council. That's a Monday night, or I'm sorry, Tuesday night. So that's not a Planning Commission meeting night. The Commission goes to the Council's meeting, and you meet together. So that's also on your calendar. So May will be a busy month with three total Commission meetings. Anything else?
Just two points to add. One is we've already started talking about the possibility of contingency if we do not finish in July. And we've asked Debbie, who's on vacation right now, to follow up with each of you individually regarding your preference for possible contingency dates. You know, we've covered our first set of topics and so far are on schedule, but want to make sure that we have a plan B in case we need one. So be looking for that from Debbie. The other comment that I'd like to make is at our next meeting, we will spend some time preparing for the joint City Council Planning Commission meeting. So we'll want to review the proposed agenda for that meeting as well as at least some sample materials for that meeting. And so I want to make sure that everybody is aware that that is in addition to what's on the agenda for ECA for that night. I do anticipate we will be going until 9 o'clock for the next few meetings, so make sure you plan on that accordingly. Any other comments, questions? Great.
Director's report from the council. I'll make it a fairly quick one. There's not much to report on. The council, as you recall, took your handoff of home business codes not too long ago. They're in the process of working through that now, and they'll start their public hearings in May. So, in fact, some of the same staff that you've working with on this subject will be working with the council to have them review your work on home business. And I'll keep the commission informed as the council works its way through that process. That's all of my report for tonight.
Wow.
Have they requested very many changes so far?
The nature of the changes that we're hearing, I've briefly described for the commission before, which is some concern that the proposed regulations from the Planning Commission may not have been sufficiently protective of neighborhoods. And recall, this is a balancing act for both the commission and the council. What we're talking about is home businesses. So right in the title, you've got a balancing act. So first, these are single-family neighborhoods where the businesses are located. than there are businesses, either existing or proposed, that want to be in there. And we need to make sure that that both uses are compatible. The onus is on the business in this case, since the residential use is the primary use. And it's all about trying to figure out what that balance is. The comments I've heard from council members are more on the, hey, we ought to be more protective of the neighborhood. We want more certainty about that protection as well. So we're working to understand how that would translate into an amendment, let's say.
And how has attendance been? Was it as brisk as it was here when we looked at it?
Not yet, because they haven't opened their public hearing. So they've just had a study session, and so no other parties attended the study session. But we've advertised, as we did for the commission, public hearings will start on May 1st, since we're televised here, and we can announce that to everybody too. And home businesses and all Sammamish residents are encouraged to attend and participate.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Cameron regarding the director's report? No. Okay, I do want to take a minute to recognize Commissioner Lipinski for his work as chair last year, since he wasn't here during our last meeting, to be recognized in person. So I just want to say thanks to Joe. It's been great working with you, and I appreciate all the hard work that went into last year.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. On that note, I want to walk through a bit about the format of today's meeting to make sure that we kind of stay on track and manage through all of this information. So we have an opportunity now for general public comment. I would respectfully request that you comment if you have something not related to the topics that we're covering today, or if you can't stay later in the evening to participate in some of the comment opportunities that we have a little bit later today. I want to walk briefly through our process for today. What will happen is we will have a best available science presentation that was prepared and will be presented by the consultants. And I believe we also have a staff presentation on the topics that we are discussing today, which I believe you see behind me. I do expect that will take a good amount of time to get through the materials, given kind of the substance of what we have to cover tonight. This is an information sharing session. There will be no decisions made today. After the presentation, we will have a brief opportunity for public comment directly to kind of the formal public comment process that many of you are familiar with. I would encourage you that if you have questions for the consultant or for staff, and this is for commissioners as well as the public, that we use the open house as an opportunity to collect those questions, maybe have some brief clarifying discussion about them. We want to make sure that all of the questions get recorded, so there's whiteboards and flip charts available to record the questions. I don't anticipate that we'll be able to answer all of your questions tonight, but our intent is to gather the questions and then, to the best of our ability, provide the answers to those questions as input to the next meeting. So what I will do is at about 7:45 today, kind of stop the formal comment process, recognizing that we may not have an opportunity to get everyone's comment in a formal manner tonight. I would encourage you to use our informal open houses as another opportunity for comment, and then we will also have an opportunity for comment at the next few sessions, which are going to be more topic specific. At those next two sessions, we will not cut off public comment. I want to be very clear about this. We want to give everybody an opportunity to speak, but today is really our opportunity to both have information gathered as well as document some of the questions for some further information that we may want. So, question?
Yes, at the end, will you be coming back together and doing some type of wrap-up?
So we will actually formally stop the taping of the meeting. We'll break for an open house. That'll be at about 7:45. And then I'll formally end the meeting at about 9 o'clock. And there will not be a follow-up public comment session at the end of the meeting. We found that that's not particularly effective. So we'll have an opportunity for public comment before we pause for the open house. And then there will be subsequent opportunities at the next few meetings. We have lots of opportunities for public comment. We'll also let you know that there's a sign-up sheet at the back. There's a way to indicate whether you want to provide comment or not. I will try to follow those indications, and I'm going to go through the list. So, like I said, if I don't get through the list today, that doesn't mean that we don't have another opportunity, but I do want to try to manage our schedule a little bit. Is that clear to everyone in the
very
commission?
Clear.
Okay. Two other things. Please hold your questions until the end of the presentation, and I actually will give the public the opportunity to comment first, and commissioners, if we don't have time, you know, we can email our comments or share that information at the next meeting. And one final reminder, we did have some ground rules about public comment. I do expect this to be a respectful environment for all of us, and I know this is a very emotional topic, so I will thank you all in advance for being mindful of that. On that note, Cameron, do you have the timer? Okay, so I will open general public comment. The process for this is to state your name and your address, and then we have a time limit of 7 minutes for each individual speaking, which I think I'm hoping not everyone will use or else we'll be here all night. So with that, I'd like to open public comment, and I believe I have someone waiting now.
Yeah. Rory Crispin, 3023 East Lake, Sammamish Parkway Southeast. This is maybe directed more towards staff, but it was brought up in the Planning
Rory,
Commission.
Could you speak up? I can't hear you, and I'd
sorry.
To hear you.
Sorry.
Thank you.
This was brought up in a Planning Commission meeting several meetings ago regarding the availability of the video that's online on the website, TV21/61. And being interested in some things that happened, I went to the browser there and saw that videos passed or prior to July of 2011 have been deleted. So the last time that this thing, I couldn't access it, the workaround was going to the calendar, go to what you were looking for on the calendar, and then playing the event media tab, which worked the last time. This time when I did it, that tab was deleted. So I was at the meeting a couple years ago when the consultant came in and claimed that they had like a bazillion bits of storage powered by the 1.21 gigawatt flux capacitor, that we would never run out of storage space. Now, I don't know if the city bounced a check or if we downgraded or what the story is, but I can't find, I looked for it under archives. I don't know where it is. Maybe the staff can come.
So, Mr. Crispin, I just want to make sure we understand. You were not able to access videos of the Planning Commission prior to July 2011. Is that correct?
Planning Commission or city council meetings.
Great. So we will respectfully request that the city investigate this, and we'll provide an opportunity to access those videos. Thank you, Mr. Crispin. Next.
Thank you. My name is Larry Crandall. I'm reside at 4335 Issaquah Pine Lake Road, Southeast, Unit 1406. I'm making a repeat not so much as performance, but speaking, because I've been accused in the past of not always finishing my thoughts in my head and then bringing up obscure information and just walking away. So I made a quote last time from Madam, and I've written it down for I can read it, Madam Kanchai Shek, we live in the past, we dream of the future, and we learn eternal truths from the past. We live in the present, we dream of the future, and we learn eternal truths from the past. And I thought that was a little too heavy, so I went and found one. I was reading something, and James Thurber came up, and his is, let us look not back in anger, nor forward in fear, but around in awareness. And I was also asked, well, why am I here? And I think the awareness takes us over, my part over to look around, let's try to preserve. And with that, I again thank the opportunity for being here. And I just wanted to say on the way here, I heard on the news that the circulation of the Sammamish Review had tripled this week. And I just wanted to point that out. Somebody's buying up all the copies. and I don't know why. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Crandall. Next.
Thank you. My name is Craig Smith, and I live at 20441 Northeast 62nd Way here in Sammamish. And I wanted to just cede my 3 minutes to Megan Gee.
Oh, thank you. Right. Is Ms. Gee here tonight?
Yeah.
Would you like to speak now or later?
Yeah.
Great.
And he is my technical person, so he's going to put in my PowerPoint, hopefully.
Ms. Gee, does this mean that we should, you're going to take more than 7 minutes?
No.
Okay.
I'm actually taking 5 minutes. I thought we had 3 minutes each, so that's why I asked him. So I was mistaken, and I apologize for going now, but I did email the Planning Commission to ask when to make my presentation. I never heard back from
them. Oh, I apologize. I don't believe we received that request.
Well,
maybe that's all right.
I have to say I'm a little bit... whatever, that you can't really email the Planning Commission. You've got to go through Debbie Beadle. And so I just sent it to her, and I never heard back. And I have my children here, and I don't think they want to stay till 9. So I really apologize. I heard what you said.
You're fine. That's all right.
I just told them they would only
don't spend your 7 minutes apologizing.
I told them they would only have to be here till 6:30. So that's why I'm going to
not a problem. I just want to confirm that the materials that you're presenting were provided to Ms. Beadle. Is that correct? As far as the
They're here. I didn't have them in time. I just wanted to know.
Okay, we'll make sure that a copy gets to her then. We want to make sure it gets recorded.
You all have them in front of you.
Right, I know it needs to be available for
and,
on the website.
And I will, I have an extra copy here, so yeah.
Perfect, thank you.
Actually, if you could email a copy so that she can have it electronically.
Okay, the problem with that is that it's a
have
big file. And I've had a hard time sending it to other people. Okay, I'll have somebody that knows how to do it. I certainly want the copy there. I'm sorry I didn't send it ahead of time.
Okay,
to change. Okay, I know. I needed a technical assistant. I just want to spend a few minutes tonight talking about small and isolated wetlands with low function, low value. I know that the consultants here tonight were given a couple of questions about small and isolated wetlands. The Citizens for Sammamish submitted an additional question we were hoping that they would be able to answer, whether best available science could support increasing that exemption to 5,000 square feet only for low function, low value wetlands, class 3 and 4. Currently, the code states that wetlands can be exempted less than 1,000 square feet. Now, this might look like there's flexibility, but in reality, there's no property in Sammamish that meets this criteria. And as far as we can tell, there's nobody that's been able to use that flexibility. We would like to propose that either that 1,000 be increased to 5,000 to give a few people more flexibility in order to use it, or better yet, we really like the City of Black Diamonds approach, where they look at small isolated wetlands for their function and value. And as long as they meet a low function, low value test and meet a certain size criteria between 1 and 4,000 square feet, then people are allowed to use a greater flexibility. And we do believe that best available science meets this, allows for this, for three different reasons. Exempting wetlands less than a quarter of an acre, which would be 10,000 square feet, is a great possibility because most, in fact, all wetland studies don't go that low or that small in evaluating wetland functions, especially if they're category 3 and 4. The second reason is that wetland rating system does not work for wetlands below 4,000 square feet. It's not reliable. And the third reason is that there are no studies found in best available science that can document the role that these small isolated wetlands play in providing water quality or hydrological functions. And that's why several cities, quite a few cities in Western Washington, have decided not to use their resources in regulating wetlands, again, that have low function, low value. They do this either basing them on low function, low value, or on size alone. We asked the city, because we hear a lot about the term cumulative impacts. Well, you know, we might not miss one, but we would miss them if you started accumulating them. Well, the City of Sammamish does not, at this present time, when we asked them, and here's the memo, they don't have a full series of mapping and inventory of the wetlands in the city. However, they can only recall two projects in the city that involve wetlands of 5,000 square feet or less. So the cumulative impact, and again, best available science only talks about a cumulative impact as it applies to amphibian studies. And again, category 3 and 4s would not be involved in, they're not good for animal habitat. So amphibian studies would not be applicable there. What are the limitations of the current code? Well, our property on Beaver Lake, we were asked by the city to get a wetland study and evaluation. We chose somebody that was off of the city's approved site to look at our property. He determined that we had an isolated, closed, depressional wetland that was 3,800 square feet. He used the wetland, the Western Washington Wetland Rating System, but did agree with best available science that this wetland rating system is not reliable below 4,300 square feet. And he said that this rating system probably overstated the water quality functions of the wetland. Nonetheless, underneath the current regulations, we have to apply a one-size-fits-all, a 50-foot buffer around that 3,800 square foot wetland, which restrains our property by 20,000 square feet. Now, that's not the only restriction we have. We have a 50-foot buffer setback from the lake. Towards the back of the property, behind that buffer, we have a 100 square foot buffer because our neighbor uses a well. And so that leaves a very small corner in the northwest section of our property that we can use to build a home. Ironically, I had a wetland biologist out to the property 2 weeks ago, and he said that is the area that is the most valuable for animal habitat. And the wetland biologist stated that the code as applied denies all reasonable economic use to our property. He did not, however, determine where the hydrology for this wetland was coming from. For that, we hired a stormwater engineering firm to determine the hydrology. They concluded that a wetland probably does not exist in natural conditions. They did this by looking at old drainage maps, stormwater drainage maps, that showed the water would naturally just flow to Beaver Lake. However, when Beaver Lake was put in over 60 years ago, they diverted over 7 acres along the drainage ditches and the pipes along West Beaver Lake Road, including an acre of untreated stormwater property coming off of the road. It goes under the road onto a private property, two parcels above ours, and then goes as sheet flow down to that 3,800 square foot depression. They determined that over 200 times the water that would naturally flow from that drainage basin outside our own is coming onto our property. And that's why they concluded that a wetland probably does not exist in natural conditions and that there is significant upstream basin draining onto our property. What does this cost us as an individual? Well, the King County Assessor's Office said that the devaluation of our property was close to $600,000. So, in conclusion, having 7 acres of stormwater on your property is not an environmental benefit. It's not a good environmental policy. EPA would tell you it's not, DOE would tell you it's not, and even AMAC would say putting 7 acres of stormwater, including an acre off of the West Beaver Lake Road, into 3,800 square feet of wetland does not benefit the environment. It might be a public benefit on private property, but it is not a good environmental policy. And that's why changing the code, giving more flexibility, would balance out environmental benefits to private property rights. That's the end of my presentation. You can see before you in the written form that I have a very large appendix that gives all supporting documentation to what I have stated tonight, and I encourage you all to look at that as you make your decision on small, isolated wetlands with low function, low value. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gee.
I'll just jump in here while he's doing that. My name's John Simpson. I'm a residential design professional. I actually have worked with the Geese as a consultant on their property in the past. I'm also a planning commissioner for the city of Newcastle, and I have worked with at the state legislative level with the American Institute of Architects on modifications to licensing law. With the occupation that I hold, complying with ordinances, codes, and state and federal laws is a mandatory aspect of my due diligence and proper function as a design consultant for my clients. Understanding, again, just with a little bit of my background, understanding that I work within those criteria, such as yourselves, in formulating those codes and ordinances, as well as working in the licensing, professional licensing language structure. The point that I wanted to make, it's real simple and straightforward, and that is when it comes to licensing laws, there are certain categories which are exempt, which you don't need to be a licensed professional to perform, and then there are certain categories where you have to be a licensed professional. When it comes to wetlands, hydrology is a key component to wetlands, and the determination of wetlands by a non-licensed professional, they are not allowed to look at contributing hydrology. So they can't look at the geese stormwater intrusion. They can only look at that specific site on the property that is wet land. And they see that the hydrology is there, but they cannot make any determination as to how the hydrology got there. If they did, they'd be practicing hydrogeology without a license. All of the, as far as I understand, all of the consultants that are preferred by staff here at the City of Sammamish are not licensed professionals. They are certified consultants, and they may have some great credentials as far as their education and their understanding of habitat and biology, but they cannot make a complete and accurate assessment of the hydrological influences to a specific piece of property. That is what is a hydrogeologist is required to perform those services. And it is against the law for those consultants to perform that service for their clients, for the property owners. So it's an inherent problem within the system that these consultants who are hired by property owners to give them delineations are going to end up with misclassifications, by and large, consistent throughout the state, because they do not have the capacity to understand the hydrological influence, the impact, the contributing effect that it has to that source. And there is a hydrogeologist here. I'm sure he would love to make a comment to that as well. There are, even within the Department of Ecology staff that are certified but not licensed, there are current claims before the geology, hydrogeology licensing board for them practicing hydrogeology without a license because they're attempting to make these assessments. At the state legislative level, for as long as I've been involved in the legislative process regarding professional licensing, wetlands biologists and soil scientists have been attempting to get their own level of licensing. And the state legislature has consistently denied that opportunity for them simply because there are already licensed professionals who provide those services, which come with a higher credential requirement, higher educational requirement, and a higher level of examination. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I do see a line forming. Please come forward. Yes, I just want to make sure that everybody remembers that there's also going to be a second opportunity for comment after we've had the presentation. Okay. Proceed.
I'm Gene Welch, and I live in Timberline Park. And you've seen me before about a month ago, and my interest is in trying to help you understand a little bit of the history of Lake Sammamish and the water quality that's that occurs there and some of the effects that have happened over the years. I've studied it for a long period of time, and you said to me, okay, write it down. So I did, and I sent it to Debbie Beadle, and she put it on the web, I guess. But your instructions say bring 7 copies, so that's what I did. I don't like to look at screens, and so I brought hard copies for you. The point here, my point is to try to help you understand how sensitive the conditions in Lake Sammamish are, and the effect of stormwater. We've measured these effects over the years, and I've tried to summarize that on 2.5 pages. And I've listed some references there, which you can go to if you desire. But if you have any questions, then you can just call me and ask me. I'd be glad to discuss anything with you. Of course, my axe is to try to influence protection of Lake Sammamish and do that in terms of land use that will provide the least footprint, because I think we can demonstrate that in order to keep the lake the way it is now, we need to provide all the prevention to stormwater impacts that we can. So.
Thank you, Mr. Welsh. Have you, did you distribute those?
It's right here.
Yeah, 7.
Oh, I think he has hard copies. That's a summary, I believe, from staff.
Okay.
Thank you. Go ahead and proceed.
Good evening. My name is Sam Rodabaugh. I am a resident of the city of Sammamish. I am also a land use attorney. That has a large portion of his caseload that often deals with critical areas ordinances and the Growth Management Act. And one of my purposes tonight is to address what I consider to be one of the legal myths regarding the Growth Management Act, which is where the city gets the requirement to adopt a critical areas ordinance. My impression in many of these circumstances with local jurisdictions adopting updated critical areas ordinances is that the city or county council, or by extension, even advisory bodies like the Planning Commission, are under the impression that the Growth Management Act creates what I refer to as a technocracy, a society that is dominated and controlled by what consultants say science requires. And my purpose tonight is to state emphatically that that is not the case. Under the Growth Management Act, local jurisdictions are specifically afforded, quote, a broad range of discretion, end quote, in the way that you plan for growth, including the protection, the designation and protection of critical areas. Further, the Growth Management states that, quote, local jurisdictions may balance priorities in full consideration of local circumstances. Now, when it comes to designating critical areas, the Growth Management Act also states that you must designate, where appropriate, critical areas, meaning there are some circumstances where it is not appropriate to designate critical areas. Now, in particular, I would like to address wetlands, and specifically Ms. Gee, on small, isolated wetlands. It may be the case that they are not appropriate for designation, or if they are appropriate for designation, that there can be greater flexibility in the way that they are regulated. Now, I was a counsel of record in one of the two biggest cases to go to our state Supreme Court on how you interpret the requirement to include best available science in designating and protecting critical areas. And in that case, our state Supreme Court said, and quite frankly, this is a direct quote, the GMA, the Growth Management Act, does not require the county to follow best available science. Rather, it is required to include best available science in the record. And then the court explained that the best available science just needs to be used in a reasoned process. And I am involved in many cases where the question is something mandated by best available science? And if so, was there a proper justification, or was it used in a reasoned process? And maybe the city council, the county council, the planning commission decided based on local circumstances that they would go a different route. So my purpose tonight is to tell you that as an extension of the city council, as an advisory board, you are afforded a wide range of flexibility under the Growth Management Act in the way that you go about designating and protecting critical areas. And even though a consultant may say, this is what you must do, you have the opportunity to look at that. And there's a reason that the discretion is afforded to you, the city, as the legislative body to make appropriate choices based on that best available science.
Thank you, Mr. Radabaugh. I would like to remind the commissioners that we do actually have copies of the GMA language in our notebooks that we can refer to. I sense that there may be a question for Mr. Radabaugh. Are you able to stay for the open house so that we have an opportunity to discuss any questions we have with you further?
Sure.
Wonderful. Thank you. Okay, I think we have one last speaker for our general public comment. Thank you.
Thank you. My name's Steve Neugebauer. I am a licensed hydrogeologist in the state of Washington, and my questions are real simple and straightforward. One of the issues is getting finite definitions for what the critical areas are, and I was just asking a question why the city of Sammamish has three different definitions for a wetland. There are city of Sammamish code 2510580, which is a definition for a wetland. 2502010, which is a definition for a wetland, and 21A151415, which is a definition for a wetland, and they're all different, very different. And one of them, the one that I just listed, which is for the critical areas ordinance, says that they should be delineated in accordance with the State of Washington Wetlands Identification Delineation Manual, which the ecology withdrew from the WAC. And now it's supposed to be the Corps of Engineers regional manual. So I just, little incidental things about best available science, but also maybe you might want to get it down to one definition. Thank you.
Wonderful. Would you please provide the written references to staff or maybe post them on one of the, you have a hard copy. That would be great if you could. Our interim administrative assistant would be happy to collect that information for you. Thank you very much. All right, I would like to close our general public comment then and proceed with the presentations. Again, it's about 6:45. We'll go until about 7:45, and we'll stop for the open house at that point, unless the consultants and staff take longer, in which case I will ask them to hurry.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We'll get started. I want to note for the record something that we said was going to happen and has started to happen here for the commission, which is part of the public comment that you'll be offered will be on individual circumstances, individual examples of how the critical areas code has been applied in the city. Ms. Gee, who was sitting there a moment ago, there she is one of those. And some of these circumstances do illustrate the policy choices the city's made to date or that you will have to make as a part of your process, so that to that extent they're very handy. The staff job is to respond and provide you with material related to that. I don't want to be rude, but there were some comments made here tonight which are just factually incorrect, and they're both opinions and facts that were stated to the commission that the staff have a responsibility as a part of that response to offer a correction. So you will see that, Ms. Gee, you will see that, Mr. Simpson will see that. As a part of the material that goes back. The thing that I regret about this is that there's a long, colorful history to some of these things. Long, colorful history to some of these things, which can get drawn out, and individuals' circumstances become part of the public discourse. It's not my goal to do that, but to the extent that material is brought into the public record here, our duty is to make sure the commission has good facts to use as a part of its deliberations. So just note for the record that you will see contravening information to some of the stuff that you will hear. Some of it will come from staff.
Thank you.
Lucky you, Alan.
That's a hard act to follow.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Evan Maxim. I'm one of the planners for the city of Sammamish. I'm just going to go over a couple of preliminary logistics. I'll try and be very brief, hopefully less than the 7 minutes allotted in general.
We can set the timer.
Got it.
Evan gets 3 minutes.
3 minutes. This goes on my review, of course. Just a quick review of our process, where we are today. You may recall we're now on the second block of topics that we're talking about. Go over a quick update, what we put into the resource guide. These materials will be posted on the internet very, very soon, as has been noted already tonight. One of the people that I've been relying on to help get material onto the website has been out of the office this week. I'm hoping that we'll be back on track on Monday. And then we'll flip over to the presentation of the best available science by AMEC and their team and go on to our open house. With that, just a quick reminder of what we're doing in terms of process. Tonight is intended primarily as a presentation of best available science information. As was alluded to a moment ago by Mr. Radabaugh, this is intended to inform the Planning Commission's decision or eventual recommendation, rather, to the planning or to the City Council, pardon me. The point of this tonight is to both present information and then solicit public input. We've had some already tonight. We're hoping that people will write down comments. We have a comment box, I'll remind everyone, at the back if you don't want to be seen writing something on a whiteboard. If you're willing, during the open house, please do make notes on the flip charts or on the whiteboard over in the corner. And then our second step in this process is to go through a more considered review of potential recommendations for the Planning Commission to evaluate. And we're gonna do that on two dates. For streams and the fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas, we're going to be looking at proposed language on May 3rd. And then for wetlands, the wetland management area overlay and the lake management area, lake management district, we'll be looking at proposed recommendations on May 17th. Those two nights, you will be essentially evaluating some draft language and deciding whether or not to advance the recommendation onto your public hearing in July or not. You are not making a final decision on either of those nights either. We're identifying additional information that might be necessary. So review process, I decided to do another graphic since it was a little bit popular last time. The intent of this graphic is to illustrate how we are moving through the process for those of us who are more visually oriented. And I apologize, I tried to make this simple. It's a bit like that Boeing 747 jet engine that I was trying to allude to last time. This gets a little bit complicated, so I've tried to break it out into step by step. Right now, where we are is on the left-hand side of the screen. We're in our two-step process. We have the best available science presentation, the question and answer, followed by public comment on proposed recommendations. We have three blocks of topics that we're talking about. We've already covered the first block, the CARA, the frequently flooded areas, in the seismic hazard. We're now looking at the best available science information on this middle block, the wetlands, streams, fish and wildlife habitat conservation area, wetland overlay, and lake management areas. And in June, we'll be looking at the landslide hazard areas and the erosion hazard near sensitive water body overlays. The intent behind this is to start to parse out our review process so we can get our hands around each topic block. As we go further into the process, at the second meeting in particular, what we'll have is follow-up evaluation by the Planning Commission and proposed language. I'm assuming that questions are going to come out of that type of evaluation by the Planning Commission. We will do our best to provide answers, which the public will then have a chance to comment on. So that is the second step in our two-step process. May 3rd and May 17th, as I mentioned a moment ago, will be the next opportunity for public comment on the wetland streams, fish and wildlife habitat conservation area, wetland overlay and lake management area.
So that's the follow-up and evaluation questions, not the public hearing, just to be clear.
Yes. I've made a mistake up on the screen here. This says public hearing. This should actually be public testimony or public comment. The public hearing, I apologize, that's very embarrassing, is in July. These are going to be inputs to the Planning Commission's deliberation. So one of the inputs, of course, is the best available science reports. As I mentioned before, they're intended to inform the process. They are not mandatory. We can get into that further if there's questions. We also have public input that you've heard tonight, and we expect to continue to hear. And you will see staff input and recommendations as we move through the process in our review. All of that leads to your deliberation, which would occur in July for the most part. And we will have the public hearing, should be noted, down here. This is the public hearing that's going to occur in July. for your eventual recommendation to the plan or to the City Council. That recommendation will consist of a couple things that we've already identified as of right now, and we likely will add to this list as we move on. You are going to have draft critical areas code that we've updated on your behalf per your direction. You'll have a summary sheet of all of the public comment that we've received to date, and this is something I'll get to in a moment, but it's in our resource guide and we are updating it regularly. You will have factual data. Some of that will be in the form of the best available science report. Some of that might be in the form that Cameron alluded to a moment ago. We are going to talk about risk a little bit. So our last conversation, we were looking at the critical aquifer recharge area, the frequently flooded hazard area, and the seismic hazard area. There were some comments by the two water and sewer districts in the city about geothermal wells and groundwater injection wells. Some of that really frankly boils down to risk and recommendations from those two districts on risk. Some of it is related to science, some of it's a risk analysis. We need to get our hands around that, and we are working on a document to help the Planning Commission do that in the near future. And then the last will be a very explicit rationale of why the recommendation has been made by the Planning Commission to the City Council for any proposed changes. Resource guide. So I'm going to switch topics now and just talk about the resource guide update very quickly. As I mentioned, the best available science reports have actually been emailed out. I think there was a gov delivery alert that went out on last Thursday, as I recall. It is attached to the Planning Commission page of the website under the agenda for tonight. It is not on the critical areas page as an update to tab 8. That will be posted, as I mentioned before, on Monday. The best available science reports were, of course, produced by AMEC, who will speak to them shortly. We have updated our comment summary matrix, and I'll get to that in a moment, but I'm gonna put off that in the next bullet, the current code correction, for two more little quick slides. I'm going as fast as I can. The fourth bullet there, the question and answer matrix, this was the staff's attempt to capture the verbal comments and verbal questions that were posed to the Planning Commission and the city during our conversation around the CARA, the frequently flooded areas, and the seismic hazard areas. We have a question and answer matrix. Many of those answers were provided by our consultant. Some were provided by the city. That has been updated and put into your resource guide tonight, and that is under tab 9. We also have a list of the follow-up questions that the Planning Commission identified at our April 5th date related to those topics. You'll note that that is still watermarked draft, that staff recommendation memo addendum. It's the last item, I believe, in your tab 9. Still marked draft because we are still actually looking for some of the responses to those questions posed by the Planning Commission. We will get that updated as soon as we can, but we wanted to start to show you how we were going to put this information together for future reference. The comment summary matrix. So the matrix right now has been updated to include the staff responses and comments, frankly, in response to the written public comment that we've received so far. That goes through April 12th, which is last Thursday. We had to kind of make a conscious decision whether or not we were going to complete the staff responses and the staff comments, or make sure that we got every comment that was turned in that intervening week, today of course being April 19th, into that table. We received three comments in the meantime, which will be on your next update, and we'll try and get that update out as soon as we can. We got one comment letter from the Department of Ecology yesterday, and actually bears on some of the comments that we've heard tonight in our presentation from the public comment. So you should pay attention to that when we can get it to you. Should be on the website very soon. We got an email from Mr. Osgood and an email from Mr. Toski via Mr. Collins earlier today, which are also not included on the summary matrix yet. We will have that matrix fully updated prior to our next meeting, which is May 3rd, and it will be updated to include, of course, the written comment that we received tonight.
So I just want to clarify, all of the materials that we have received through today will be available on Monday, is that correct?
On Monday,
that's our
yes.
Expectation. Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
So the current code, we did have one of those awkward moments. We did have one of those awkward moments as we were reviewing the wetland best available science report, where we noted that amendments to the critical areas ordinance that were actually adopted in August of 2011, concurrent with the Shoreline Master Program adoption, were not included in the code that we had posted onto our website and codified. They were legally adopted and legally in effect by ordinance by the City Council, but they weren't codified and available for public review on our resource guide. These related to two items, and we have updated your resource guide to reflect that appropriately. The first was there was a requirement that we update our wetland mitigation ratios. You'll see the code citation here on the screen. If you go to our website now and pull up the current municipal code, that is reflecting the current mitigation ratios. Those have changed in the past week or two. Similarly, we have a specific provision under our fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas where we explicitly note that lakes, we used to call lakes a fish and wildlife habitat conservation area, they are no longer noted as that. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Cliff. I don't think I made my seven-minute timeline.
10:36, so you know.
Who was counting?
I was.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, and members of the audience. My name is Cliff Strong. I'm with AMEC Environment and Infrastructure, the consulting firm that your city has chosen to help you through this process. I am the project manager, or ringmaster, if you will, but we have a slew of experts that are looking into each of the various topics that the city is addressing. Tonight, we have with us Cleve Stewart, our senior fisheries biologist. Cleve, you want to just raise your hand. Brian Taylor, our stormwater engineer, and Dr. Christy Duncan, our senior wetlands biologist. So they'll be making the presentations on each of the topics. Just a brief note on what our role is. Our role has been to research the best available science, which includes the science, but also new laws and best professional practices. And we are here to assist the city in understanding any new requirements or science. We evaluate the best available science as it applies to the city-directed questions and the known topics document that they've provided us. Our goal is to try to inform the city of where the existing code may not comply with the newest science or regulations or law. We will not be developing any policy or code for the city, and the city council will be making all final policy decisions. So we're just here to support the staff and the city in coming to your decisions.
Great, thank you.
So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Cleve Stewart.
Thank you, Cliff. Good evening. I'm a fisheries biologist by training. I've got 30 plus years as a researcher, as a fisheries manager, and as a consultant. I sit on the RIA 8 Salmon Recovery Council, where I've enjoyed the company of Don Jaron for several years, gotten to know him a little bit. And I've also worked on some of your streams and some of your neighboring municipality watersheds as well. I'm going to speak tonight about streams and fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas. Let me make sure I've got controls going here. All right. And where's my pointer? Okay. Got it. Try not to laser the Planning Commission here.
Thank you.
Okay. So just a brief overview of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to explain briefly what the systems of interest are, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the science, its use in the context of policy making and updating your ECAs. I'm going to talk about the ecological functions and values of these systems, really what it is that we're trying to protect, if that's the goal. We're going to discuss the basic underpinning support, scientific support for the city's existing regulations. And then we're going to present our findings and recommendations related to those recommendations. Okay, just a few definitions for those of you that didn't bring your dictionaries. The fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas are those state lands and water bodies that provide conditions that are essential to maintaining viable species, populations of species, terrestrial and aquatic. Streams, of course, are recognizable as flowing water within a confined channel, defined banks, And riparian, this term may not be familiar, you may not be familiar with, refers to the streamside or wetland adjacent vegetation, and it, as I'll explain, provides valuable functions to protect those areas. Okay. And then shorelines of the state, I'm going to refer to those. They include virtually all water bodies with the following exceptions, and these are many. Shorelines that are identified as having statewide significance, any streams smaller than 20 CFS, that's not particularly large, small lakes less than 20 acres in size, and then wetlands that are associated with the second and third of those four. Okay, these when we refer to fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas, we're basically referring to these areas that have special or unique values. That is, they can have species that are either threatened or endangered under federal law or classified as sensitive species under state law. They can be species that have particularly high value in terms of recreation and commercial benefits. Shellfish beds, there aren't many of those in Sammamish, but they are classified as commercially important. Ecologically unique habitats, these are areas that fish depend upon in order to complete their life cycle. Wildlife habitat corridors are a special category. These are contiguous areas of open space that animals use to migrate or move from one habitat area to the next. Okay, within the jurisdiction here, we have Lake Sammamish and Beaver and Pine Lakes. They are classified as shorelines of the state, as I just defined it. Most of the streams in this area originate on the plateau here and flow west. They drop quickly over a steep gradient through ravines before discharging into the lake. That's somewhat unique in that it influences both the physical processes that occur in those streams and the distribution of fish. Evans Creek flows directly to the Sammamish River, and Patterson Creek flows to the Snoqualmie. Okay, Lake Sammamish, a natural resource of statewide significance. It's home to many fish species, some you probably aren't familiar with because they aren't salmon or trout, but they are important nonetheless as members of the community. There are popular sports fisheries and recreation, boating, that type of thing. And of course, the lake is heavily developed along the its shoreline. Although it's not urban, it's still highly modified. And then the lake, as you'll hear from my colleague, Brian Taylor, has water quality issues. But overall, it's still relatively clean. And to a certain extent, that's because of regulations that have been imposed in the past. We've got several species of salmon and trout. The ones that have garnered the most attention are Chinook salmon, because they are currently listed as threatened species under the Endangered Species Act. They are the Puget Sound Chinook. They aren't just the population that comes into Lake Sammamish. We do have good numbers of Chinook returning to the Issaquah Hatchery. Within the streams of Sammamish, there is no documented Chinook spawning. They're large-bodied fish, and therefore they need generally large streams, such as Issaquah Creek, to spawn in. But we do see juveniles of this species migrate along the shoreline, and they're highly dependent on this as refuge from predators, and they often dip into the mouths of these tributaries that empty into the lake. So they are important refuge systems and feeding and rearing locations for these species, and so therefore they're generally singled out for protection. Coho salmon are probably the most abundant of the salmon species. They're found in smaller streams. They reside in the stream as juveniles for a year before heading out to the ocean. Sockeye salmon migrate out immediately as fry, and then they spend a year rearing in Lake Sammamish or Lake Washington before going to the ocean. Now, kokanee, you've probably heard of because they're somewhat unique in this area. We have an indigenous population of kokanee. These are the smaller landlocked variety of sockeye salmon. There are three stream systems within the Lake Sammamish drainage where they spawn. Ebright is one of them. And if you have a chance, get out there and watch them. They're brightly colored, and they can be quite entertaining. They spawn, they move in mass. This lake or this stream is important for their long-term viability. Cutthroat trout are more common than most people think. They reside for many years, sometimes their entire life cycle within streams. Okay, stream functions, these are obvious. They convey water, sediment, wood, anything really that's entrained in the flow. They provide habitat for fish and other aquatic organisms. They provide educational, recreational opportunities. Riparian, I want to take a little more time. I'm sorry, this is a busy slide, but we wanted to, because buffers, riparian buffers are often a flashpoint for discussion of we want to talk about why they're important from an ecological standpoint. So they tend to absorb, store, release nutrients. They filter sediment. They protect the banks, their root systems, protect the banks from eroding. They shade the stream. That prevents algae from growing. It keeps water temperatures down. They serve as a source of food. Insects drop into the stream. Fish eat them. Downed trees are very important governors of the complexity of the habitat that's present, especially in Pacific Northwest streams. If you have a down log, oftentimes you'll have scour and complex habitat that fish take advantage of. So riparian systems are also home to terrestrial and avian species that are very dependent on that type of habitat. Flood storage, banks over top, waters spread out, and as they recede back to the stream, that's modulated by the riparian system. Education and recreation and aesthetics are also important. Okay, what makes a buffer effective? Well, there are many things, not just how wide it is. Among the more important factors are the composition and structure of the vegetation, the soil, its type and quality, and then around here, slope is important. I mentioned the steep ravines. Well, buffers on steep slopes tend to provide less protection than do equivalent with buffers on flat slopes. Okay, and then, of course, the effect itself depends on the condition of the receiving stream and the constituent biota. All right, but generally, as a rule, the wider the buffer, the greater the protection. But how wide? What's optimal? Well, that's hard to say. We've got science. Science is a guide. It indicates the direction and magnitude of these functions as a function of width, but there's no magic line. In truth, every site is unique, and the ideal buffer is site-specific. Okay, so one of the things that we did in compiling the science to inform this discussion was to look at other reviews. This happens to be a very good one that was done locally by Chris May. He summarized all the functions that I just went over, and they're down the left here. The range of reported buffer widths, these are recommended by the research that Chris uncovered. And then he just summarized in the form of minimum recommended widths in this column. Now, these are fairly large numbers compared to what the city is proposing and what is actually implemented in other jurisdictions. The truth is we aren't going to achieve 100% unless we push everybody back a long distance. For instance, this large wood debris, LWD, this is the wood that falls into the stream that I talked about. Well, ideally, you want to have a buffer that's essentially equivalent to the height of a Doug fir, a mature Doug fir, because that'll fall over and presumably some of the down trees will land in the stream. So that's how that's figured, thought about. Okay, but we wanted to put the existing buffer widths and the existing regulations in perspective. So we line them up next to, this is Sammamish in this column, next to other jurisdictions, starting with King County. We've got Issaquah, Redmond, and Bellevue. And what we've got down the left-hand side are the stream typing system. These are different types of water bodies. The shorelines of the state signify by S. F is fish-bearing. N is non-fish-bearing. It's broken into two categories. One is perennial, that is flowing year-round. The other is seasonal or intermittent. And then we've got a category that's O, non-fish-bearing. These are isolated water bodies. Neither S, F, or N. Everything else goes into O. Okay, so we, the city of Sammamish, have recommended that these buffer widths. I'm going to talk about these in terms of the recommendations that science seems to support. Okay, just notice, though, that the general range of values on any given row, the city is not the highest. It's reasonable in terms of where it falls within the range listed here. Again, I'm going to talk about some of these numbers and give you some ideas of whether they should be modified or not. Okay, so we find that the stream typing system is consistent with the states. It's generally sound. It's a good way of categorizing, classifying the system. What we're suggesting is that for type F streams, these are the fish-bearing streams, that you not allow the development of roads, trails, or park projects. I'm sorry, that you not allow the relocation of the streams to accommodate road, trail, or park projects. Okay? We are suggesting that you allow for the relocation of type F streams for restoration projects. And the reasoning here is we're restoring the stream to some semblance of a natural state. Oftentimes that requires putting a meander in to a channelized system or moving it back into its original channel. In that case, we're recommending that restoration be allowed to move those channels. Okay, I mentioned that I'm into the recommendations now. And I'm specifically going to talk about buffers over the next several slides. I mentioned that the stream typing system is good. The buffer widths and building setbacks, as I mentioned when we saw the table, generally fall within the range of best available science recommendations and neighboring jurisdictions' regulations. Okay, but relative to those other jurisdictions, Sammamish requires a wider buffer on these small non-fish, that is the type N bearing perennial streams. I'll mention this again. What I feel, what the science supports is that we allow for narrower 50-foot buffers for those types of streams that do not directly feed into salmon-bearing waters. So you can conceive of this as a stream that does not support fish, a tributary that enters into a stream that does not support fish. We're recommending that slightly narrower buffers are allowed to preserve, and if allowed, they would still preserve the functions and values of those systems. Okay, we feel that the seasonal streams, where 50-foot buffers are currently required, that feed directly into Lake Sammamish, which, as we mentioned, is a shoreline of state significance, that those buffer widths be maintained, that no changes be made. On these type O water bodies, these are the isolated surface waters, the seeps and so forth, that don't connect by surface flow to other water bodies, we feel that a 25-foot buffer is appropriate under those conditions. Okay, trails and use of riparian systems by people, passive recreation, that type of thing, is popular. We feel that trails should be allowed, that an equivalent amount of width for the width of the, equivalent to the width of the trail be added to the buffer. But in general, we feel that trails crossing an aquatic area, whether it's a stream or another area, they should be constructed on raised boardwalks or bridges. A lot of what we do is, as stream restoration specialists, is make sure that we get the stream up and away from the banks and the bed. Whether you're talking about culverts or roadside, we tend to try to create this natural condition that will allow the stream to function as it wants without being confined by a rigid boundary. Okay, continuing, flexibility is important. Buffer reductions may be appropriate under certain circumstances, but generally, we're recommending that you avoid reducing buffers unless there is compelling evidence that there can be mitigation can be implemented that will result in a net gain or net improvement in ecological functions. It's important that we document that net improvement and not just claim or predict that it'll occur. And for that reason, we're recommending that monitoring and evaluation be part of that, and that if the performance goal, the net improvement is not observed, that additional mitigation be imposed. I want to state as a cautionary note that cumulative effects are important, especially when in a larger watershed where so many things are happening. And we don't have a good handle on the effects over time and over the landscape that many of these actions have. So generally, a precautionary approach is recommended. Buffer increases are also appropriate, and many people voluntarily choose to leave large buffer widths to increase the functional value of the buffer. We're suggesting that in some cases, buffer width should be required where there are conditions such as high quality habitat that extends beyond the standard buffer width, that the effects of steep slopes, highly erosive soils, very active channels, these types of things tend to reduce the effectiveness of buffers, and therefore a wider buffer is warranted. And then if you have sensitive species, a nest, a bald eagle nest or a heron nest, or some other type of unique habitat or use of that riparian area, that a wider buffer width should be considered. Okay, so concluding our recommendation for these fish and wildlife habitat conservation areas, no update, no change to the existing code is recommended. Wildlife habitat corridors, I didn't point this out in the table that I showed you, but they are the areas that typically require the largest or greatest width, the largest space to accommodate the movements of often large-bodied animals. The city does have code related to this. If we've recommended that it be reviewed and based on public input, because again, this is a value judgment, what species are important. Once that's done, that information is obtained, refer to the Department of Fish and Wildlife's management recommendations for priority species. And then combine that, if the goal is to expand the habitat corridors, to do that, not at the expense of existing development, but try to accommodate what's out there now and to take advantage of the opportunity for expanding the corridors themselves. Okay, I think that takes care of it. I don't have any idea how long I went. I just right. went.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Cleve. I'm Brian Taylor. I'm a stormwater engineer at AMEC, and I'm going to talk about the lake management areas. So I was glad to see Dr. Welch here. 20 years ago, I was in Dr. Welch's limnology class at the UW, so appreciate your earlier comment, Gene. And as Dr. Welch pointed out, as we got going, the city of Sammamish, all the water resources here drain to Lake Sammamish, which is a sensitive lake. And there are also several lakes within the city that are sensitive, and that doesn't mean that they get all weepy during TV shows or something. It means that they're susceptible to increases in nutrient loadings that can cause them to have health problems with the ecological values that the lakes provide. And you can start to have impacts in the lakes when you have increased nutrient loadings that can lead to effects such as, you know, increased vegetative growth. They get overgrown with plants and algae. You have algae blooms, which can deplete the oxygen in the lake, which has detrimental effects on the organisms that are living in the lake. And it also impacts, of course, when these things happen, the how people recreationally would use a lake. So phosphorus comes from a lot of different places, and I'm going to touch on that here. But this is the main concern we have about the lakes in the city, is that based on the past, there were some challenges with the amount of phosphorus that was going into it. Phosphorus levels are rising, and some of these symptoms were starting to be seen. So the critical areas ordinance as it is today addresses that by having fairly stringent controls, stormwater controls for development and activities in the watersheds of these lakes. The lakes that we're talking about are Pine Lake and Beaver Lake. They each have a lake management area established, which is basically the watershed that contributes water when it rains that makes it in, or even sometimes water that is, if it soaks into the ground and infiltrates near enough to the lake, it still makes its way there. So there have been some different studies, and the references are in the report, that on both Beaver Lake and Pine Lake. And these studies that are out there have shown that it appears that the lakes have largely, these two lakes have largely stabilized because of some of the past policies to control the phosphorus. And they're both of the studies that I reviewed on Beaver Lake and the Pine Lake, you know, were saying that basically we should try to keep up this 80% phosphorus control standard to further, you know, control the phosphorus loadings, but that the negative downward trend in some of the parameters that you look at to measure this, which is like visibility, the phosphorus content, concentrations in the water, that these trends had somewhat decreased. So our recommendations are that we keep this standard where it is on that. For comparison, King County, Washington State for a lake would require a 50% phosphorus control for new stormwater. As I said, the current code recommends that phosphorus get reduced by 80%. So what happens, you know, the practice of this is if somebody's put in a new development or a redevelopment activity, you have to put in BMPs to control how much phosphorus comes off and to take it out of the water stream. Right now, the code is written with a rather prescriptive list of practices. And that's what my last, that's what my last bullet up there. I can't get the pointer to work. In any case, that's what the last bullet is referring to. So this code came out in 2005, and there's been more recent guidance from both the state and King County as they have incorporated different ways of managing phosphorus. And so what we're recommending is that, let me go back. For example, the Department of Ecology has a system where if there's what they would call emerging technology, some method of taking stormwater that's generated on a site and treating it to remove phosphorus, if there's something out there that's sort of new, they have a protocol that people can go through where you monitor how effective this is, and after years of testing and research, the state will designate that these things are acceptable for general use for controlling phosphorus. So this is really a great resource to use because it's a very stringent protocol. Places all around the U.S. actually refer to Department of Ecology's TAPE protocol, it's called, and refer to that as a way to demonstrate that a stormwater management practice is effective at what it is, what, you know, it is claiming it can do for stormwater. And so it would be worth considering to allow these sort of emerging technologies, and these could be things like catch basin filters that have a special media that removes phosphorus. That's one practice that can be done. We're recommending that these be given a look, that the city consider these to be acceptable if the state considers them to be acceptable for removing phosphorus. And what this does is it gives people more flexibility. You have a standard out there, you have to take out a certain amount. And so having as many tools in the toolbox as possible to do that helps you, gives people more abilities. I think the code right now is written that you need a particularly large wet pond to remove phosphorus, and that's certainly one practice that works. There are other things such as treatment trains or constructed wetlands or sand filters followed by special media filters. And the list kind of goes on. And so what we've proposed here in the BAS report is that that those kind of things be allowed to be used with the backup that somebody has actually put together loading calculations to demonstrate in that way that how these would work. What we would expect would be needed would be a chain of BMPs or management practices sequentially that the water would go through when it leaves the site to knock the phosphorus back on it. The code also speaks to, as it is today, I'm not necessarily losing my place. I don't have a bullet for it specifically. The code today also speaks to that one way to control phosphorus is to set aside part of the site that remains in an undeveloped state. Phosphorus gets introduced to stormwater largely through soil disturbing activities as one thing. It also gets introduced to stormwater through things that people put onto the landscape often, such as fertilizers and whatnot. So the standards that are in the current code are basically saying that new impervious surfaces whenever somebody puts in a new impervious surface, that this phosphorus standard would be triggered. So if you're over the threshold and you put in, a new paved area subject to vehicular traffic, you would have to put in a treatment system for the stormwater. What we're suggesting is that this might be worth looking at expanding to also include redevelopment activities, because the goal here is to control how much phosphorus is coming off so that we're not fertilizing the lakes, promoting eutrophication. And regardless of whether it's a new development or a redevelopment, that effect is going to be the same when that surface is changed. Also, it's worth looking at pervious pollutant-generating areas. What that means is this is part of the landscape. It's not impermeable, it's not impervious. It's a landscaped area or a lawn, and lots of times people use fertilizers and landscaping products that are actually adding phosphorus to the system. And fertilizers are really touchy. If you put too much on, it enters the runoff stream and it makes it to the lake. So the state has recently passed a law that goes into effect next year that limits the amount of phosphorus that is in turf fertilizer. So that's going to be a state law that'll be in effect in the city of Sammamish as well as everywhere else in the state. But that is just limited to turf. And so it's worth considering if something more stringent would be appropriate in these sensitive basins that also affects fertilizers that would be applied to, other landscape features, whether it's a planting bed or gardening or things like that. So controlling what is put into the landscape that can find its way to the stormwater flow stream and make it into a lake is a strategy that is pretty consistently promoted by State of Washington, King County. These are called source control BMPs, and the idea is that you prevent something that would have harm if it got into the water. You just keep it from ever getting in contact with the water to begin with. So some of the practices that are typically used for this, specifically for controlling nutrients, are restricting car washing, because a lot of detergents and washing agents, have phosphates in them. Emphasizing that animal waste be properly disposed of, because it also has the potential to have nasty things come out of it and flow downstream. And as I mentioned before, reducing the use of all fertilizers with phosphorus. That concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor.
Well, good evening, commissioners, members of the city of Sammamish, and guests. My name is Christy Duncan, and I'm senior wetlands biologist with AMEC. I'm here to discuss what we have worked on over the last few months in examining the best available science. And I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview of what I'm going to present and then launch right into it. And hopefully you're not too saturated, and I'll try to keep this brief.
Could you pull the microphone a little closer to you?
A little closer? Is that better?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Good. Wetlands regulation and definition, very briefly. I'm sure this audience is well informed. I'm quite convinced of it. And then a little bit about what science tells us and how it should be used. Protecting the desirable ecosystem functions that we do have on the landscape. And what has science developed over the last few years that can inform policy decisions here in the city? And lastly, I will discuss some of the recommended changes to the critical areas ordinance. It's interesting to see how wetlands regulation has evolved from wetland science over the last couple of decades. And this definition is the federal definition for wetlands. And most people are fairly familiar with it. And you'll notice that it has a number of features. It's a definition that has stabilized now and is used by most jurisdictions, and it should be the definition that the city of Sammamish uses. Wetland functions are an important aspect of wetlands. It's really why we care about wetlands. It's what wetlands do for us on the landscape that really is the focus. What we see is a number of sort of outcomes of the interaction of vegetation and water and soil on the landscape. One of the most important and frequently discussed aspects of wetland function is wetland's ability to retain extra water during a storm. So basically detain water in locations that prevent downstream flooding as a result. Groundwater discharge and recharge are very dynamic in wetland systems, especially in Washington, where we have very wet systems during the winter and then subsequently quite dry systems in many locations in the summer. As a result of both these storage and retention and groundwater exchanges, we see water quality improvements as a result of wetlands on the landscape. And that's a very important function that affects then the things that both Cleve and Brian were discussing in terms of streams and lake quality. After we look at sort of the water and soil interaction, the secondary aspect that we often think about when it comes to function for wetlands is their relevance to plants and animals in the landscape. So we know in many cases wetlands are the place to find threatened and endangered plant and animal species, and and also a large variety of a number of interesting invertebrates, amphibians, birds, and larger wildlife. We recognize wetlands as important features on the landscape for passive recreation, providing open space, and other aesthetic functions. So given that they are unique hydrologic and biologic systems, how do we go about protecting them? Well, we can actually protect the wetlands themselves, and also in most jurisdictions, including Sammamish, we provide a buffer for those functions of some width. Wetland buffers are those areas that are... I have a little different of a handout than this. The wetland buffers are vegetated areas that are adjacent to aquatic resources, and they can, through various physical and chemical or biological actions, result in providing protection to wetland functions. In addition, and this is sometimes overlooked, wetland buffers themselves provide habitat for terrestrial species, and some of those terrestrial species rely on the wetlands for part of their life history. So there's an interlink on the landscape between the upland habitat and the wetland habitat. buffer effectiveness. Just how do buffers work? And this slide you saw in just a slightly different form earlier for Cleve's presentation, because stream buffers are riparian areas and wetland buffers function very similarly. And the effectiveness is also a very similar set of characteristics. So what we look at is site-specific conditions, including important factors such as slope, vegetation composition, soil composition is very important, and then buffer width. And then in addition, we also want to look at the characteristic of the wetland that the buffer is adjacent to. And in general, and this is science has supported this, that we see greater protection with greater buffer widths. There's not much exception to that characteristic. In any situation on the landscape, we really need to look specifically before you can actually determine the most appropriate buffer width. And that's since it seems a whole lot of work to do it case by case, we actually end up with a set of standards. Now, science has been very busy on the forefront in looking at just what you do with buffers and how they respond to provide specific functions. One of the notable things on this slide, I don't have a pointer, but if you look, oh yes, I do. On the very top row, bottom one, thank you. Right here, sediment control. We've spoken of in regards to sediment control for streams as well as for lakes, and this is in terms of wetlands. And one of the very interesting feature here is that buffers as small as 5 to 10 feet wide can actually remove sediments from surface waters moving across a vegetated area. 60% of the sediments were removed. So even very small buffers do have some effect in protecting water quality for the adjacent aquatic system. One of the other salient features here that I'd like you to note is this one way down here, under wildlife habitat. It's commissioners, it's the third from the bottom, 1,000 feet. And this is from a study that looked at wildlife use and buffers. And for wildlife use, up to 1,000 feet or even greater in order to retain the full diversity of bird species in Puget Sound. And what we see is that with smaller buffer widths, the larger birds, raptors, and the birds that are dependent on snags, like flickers and pileated woodpeckers, will leave the area because there's not quite enough of habitat. So we need the wider widths for those species. And then if you notice the rest of the ranges where we're actually seeing some effectiveness for buffers are very similar to what we see in our already standing regulations. Similar to what Cleve said, when it comes to buffer widths, we're already in the realm of getting something with them, and we're not missing the mark very far. So here's a table that describes buffer widths for five jurisdictions in most of your neighbors here in the city of Sammamish: Bellevue, Issaquah, Redmond, King County. This is for wetlands. And on the very on the very left-hand category, we have column. We have wetland categories, category one down through category four. These are classifications of wetlands based on their functional capability. And what you notice is that in the third column over, we have the ecology's guidance. Now, this is what they recommend for buffer width. And they range quite a bit. So for instance, here in category two, their guidance is very broad, 75 feet up to 300 feet for category two wetland protection. For the city of Sammamish, as the code stands now, You can see that the, as expected, category ones have a larger buffer width, and then category four are at 50 feet right now. These are not very different in general from either Issaquah or Bellevue. And you notice here the city of Redmond, they actually have their buffer widths are all in ranges. And I want to talk a little bit more about what that is and why we think that's a really good idea. Let's see. So I have my slides are in a little different order. And I was just hold that thought in your mind about buffer widths and why we think that having a range for a particular category is a good idea. And we'll talk about our the next slide here and then circle back. So mitigation sequencing is what we do when we're approaching the question of whether a wetland on the landscape should be protected or if it needs to be impacted, how does this happen? Mitigation sequencing is a tiered set of steps that one must take in order to evaluate, in any case, the ability for wetlands to be permitted for impacts. The first is, in all cases, avoid impacts to the greatest extent possible. And if the development can't avoid impacts, to move to the next step, which is to minimize those impacts. So take whatever necessary steps are available to avoid that impact or minimize it. If neither of those are possible, then perhaps the impact can be temporary, and following the impact, we rectify the damage that was done, and then reduce or eliminate the impact over time. And then this next one is the one compensate, is when we are at a position in a position where the design or the proposed development or whatever the change on the landscape is proposed is now in a position to say that the impact is minimized and completely unavoidable. So you've taken steps to make these impacts as small as possible and examined all potentials for not having this impact. In that case, the wetland should be compensated for. So wetland compensation takes a number of different approaches. There's restoration, creation. These are all ways that someone can propose that if one wetland is impacted by development, that another system be either improved or perhaps even created on the landscape. This slide has a number of things on here that you may have not seen before because they're not currently here in the city of Sammamish, and there are two on the bottom, or actually these three, mixed compensatory mitigation, which I'll talk a little bit about in a few minutes, and then wetland mitigation banking and in-lieu fee programs. These are two compensation alternatives which are, in scientific terms, considered the cutting edge. They are the way that compensation should be provided, and according to the EPA, the Army Corps, and other federal agencies that are concerned about wetland preservation, it's the preferred way for providing compensation for impacts. There are some unique wetlands and conditions in Sammamish that should be considered by the Planning Commission in discussing and deliberating their critical areas ordinance. Bog wetlands are actually fairly rare in the state of Washington, in Western Washington at this time, particularly in the lower elevations, and that's due to historic development and exploitation of bogs for their peat resources historically. Here in Sammamish, I think it's almost well known, regionally well known, that there are some very beautiful bog systems here. Small and isolated wetlands on a plateau situation are very common. It's interesting that they aren't mapped yet in Sammamish, but they could be. Small wetlands can now be picked up quite readily with aerial photographic interpretation, where a few years ago that was harder to do. We've really moved along on that technology. Man-modified wetlands, very common all around Western Washington. Wetlands have been our agricultural fields, and they've been ditched and altered in a number of ways. permitted alterations. There's many permitted alterations as well as historic alterations to wetlands. And then here in Sammamish, you have a wetland overlay district, which is not very common for many of the jurisdictions in Western Washington, but a very interesting aspect of the Critical Areas Code that's actually quite effective. So implications of those conditions in Sammamish and some of the things that I've mentioned, we have made a number of recommendations. So one of the first ones is pretty straightforward, and this one should not be passed up. And let me put this in a little bit of what's happened over the last few years. The state of Washington had put a manual out in 1997, and that manual took what was an older federal manual and updated it. And it was much needed, and it was a very good manual. The state had not updated their manual in a number of years when the federal government updated their older manual by issuing supplements. So the state, instead of trying to make this a horse race, did the easy thing, which was to eliminate the state manual. So now we have a federal manual that is 1987 and a very recent set of two supplements which apply to Washington and in this area. So the federal manual was adopted by Washington, and that's the 1987 Army Corps of Engineers manual. And then with that, the two supplements were adopted. So it's a little confusing. A lot of people think that the supplements are the new manual, and that's not the case. You have to take them all together. You have to take the old 87 manual plus its supplement. It truly is a supplement. It's not a replacement. So for most jurisdictions, the easiest way forward to keep the language consistent across all jurisdictions and make things march in time for development is to adopt that Army Corps 1987 manual and the two supplements. The second point that we would like to make and make a recommendation for is to emphasize more of a watershed approach to mitigation. Now, what does that mean? There's actually a lot behind that statement. A watershed approach is really the cutting edge in how compensation should be provided. And what a watershed approach means is that you move away from what has been historically seen as most relevant, which was, if you're going to impact a wetland, replace the wetland in as near physical location to that impact as possible. And so the concept of on-site and in-kind what has been adopted. Instead, what it really came out of work from the National Academy of Sciences looking at wetland compensation over the last 15 years, and they stepped back and they said, what we really should be doing is taking a watershed approach. We should be looking for the opportunities to implement compensation where it can make the greatest improvement at when we look at the watershed overall and not take a sort of pinpoint approach. So what that means is that if you have a wetland in point A, say out near Beaver Lake, and that the Beaver Lake watershed is missing some function, and that function can be replaced in another physical location, but within that sub-basin, that may be a very good approach to providing compensation. It's a new idea. The state of Washington has bought into it, and actually they were some of the folks that were thinking for a long time it would be a very good way to start doing mitigation. It's a big change for local jurisdictions because local jurisdictions are very much concerned with keeping things within jurisdiction and not looking at watersheds. And we all know watersheds often cross jurisdictional boundaries, or maybe I should put it the other way. Jurisdictions are formed irregardless of watershed boundaries. So they may have only a very small portion of a watershed within a jurisdiction. Here in Sammamish, it's actually a very unique situation where many of the sub-basins, you actually have headwaters in your jurisdiction, as well as what can be considered the sort of delta at Lake Sammamish, or over in the Snoqualmie or Skykomish. So really, you could think of it as having control over the majority of the basin and really influence it as a whole watershed. Let's see. As a third recommendation that we'd like to make is that we look at mitigation ratios in more detail. And what we mean by that is looking at something, let's see if this table is here, something like this. In addition to evaluating the compensation that's provided in terms of area and just a number, an acreage number, also look at two other aspects. One is what the intensity of the adjacent development will be, but also what is the kind of compensation being provided. So earlier we had we had fee in lieu and banking, and we also had a number of other compensation listed. We had on the earlier slide creation, rehabilitation, and enhancement. And what this does is it takes a simple ratio and actually makes it a little more, I guess you could just say complicated, but actually this is more sophisticated. And I think there's a fine and important distinction in that sophistication actually ends up with a much better outcome from an ecosystem perspective. And that if you do enhancement only for a wetland impact in providing compensation, what we mean by enhancement is taking an existing wetland and making the function better by providing some usually vegetation that's missing, you end up with a net loss in acreage of wetlands. It's unavoidable. You can't compensate. It's already wetland and you're impacting wetlands, so overall the balance is a net loss. So for these numbers actually come from the city of Redmond. So what they've said is if you're going to have a Category 1 forested wetland and you're going to impact it, and you're only going to provide enhancement, then you need a 24-to-1 ratio. That's a big burden for most development, and it's actually that high because of the net loss. In addition, because it's a big burden, it's also a discouragement for that, for going in that direction, and they're saying, okay, we're going to give you a bit of a carrot to look at both enhancement and perhaps a bit of creation and restoration for compensation. And in that way, we minimize the loss because you're providing some wetland area that compensates for the actual impact. This can be difficult at first to implement if staff is not comfortable with mixing ratios of creation and enhancement. But the city of Redmond has been has had this for about 5 years now, and they're actually finding it works quite well once everybody kind of get their head around it. So this is one of our recommendations, that this kind of, it's just taking the existing ratios and adding on a little more. What is the ratio being, how are we meeting that ratio, looking at the other side of the equation? So that's mitigation, that's really recommendations related to mitigation that I've covered, and now I'm going to talk a little bit about buffer recommendations. One of the things that we noted kind of a different situation here in Sammamish than some of the other local jurisdictions, and actually it's quite different than what science recommends, because if you remember, I said that buffer function is very dependent on the system that it's not only the system that it's protecting, but also the landscape position and the condition of the buffer. And so what we're recommending is that that side of the science be actually incorporated into your critical areas ordinance by allowing buffer reduction or modification on a very well-documented case-by-case basis, and that it be qualified, be justified by qualified best professional judgment. And some of the important aspects are, is that buffer connected? So is it providing a wildlife corridor or some other function? Is the buffer well vegetated, or is it all invasive species? So in general, in Western Washington, invasive vegetation is poorly functioning relative to our native species in terms of buffer functional capability. So that provides just two little examples of how you might look at this in terms of the characteristic of the buffer itself, in terms of whether a buffer should be reduced, or in some cases maybe there should be other modifications. For instance, some portion of the buffer should be widened because it's adjacent to some feature that is particularly valuable. I mentioned that the latest federal delineation manual should be adopted, so we don't need to cover that again. And then this is sort of operational. So critical area studies are required right now by the code, but the way the code is written, the scope of the study does not require what could potentially be the entire buffer for a system. And other jurisdictions have realized that over the years, and so they've included a requirement that the critical area study scope include the area 200 or sometimes 250 feet beyond the property boundary. And what that does is it encapsulates, depending on your code, but the concept is it would encapsulate the largest buffer, say if a system went right up to a property boundary or even extended beyond the property boundary. Staff would then have in that study information that would allow a more complete evaluation of how that system was situated in the landscape. The big barrier to implementing these studies is that many times there isn't access to adjacent properties. But we have tools in our kit now with Google Earth even the University of Washington's online aerial photo database. There's a number of ways to sort of use other eyes to peer into adjacent properties and get an idea of what's there. So to the extent that it's possible to look at that, it should be documented. We recommend that the critical area studies incorporate that extra width and that be part of the documentation. And that's the last comment up there, last bullet. I mentioned the watershed approach. And this, again, the in-kind and on-site versus off-site or out-of-kind. We also mentioned that kind of mitigation proposed also be part of the calculation. And we've talked about all these. One of the recommendations that we were asked specifically to look at was the town center area for the city of Sammamish. And there was some question about code and that area and how it's the planning is going for that. And our recommendation is that the city look at providing justification for why the town center area is actually excluded from vegetation standards within the wetland management area specifically. So there needs to be some justification for that and in some way acknowledging that right now there's a conflict within the code as to those two areas. So any questions?
I think there are many.
Oh, not for me, sorry. No.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So I want to just point out it's 8:05, and we have 6 people that have not yet provided their public comment that have signed up, and 4 that were indicating possiblys. And if each of you gets 7 minutes, we'll be here until after 9:00. So I want to make sure that everyone has an opportunity to speak tonight that feels as though that's very important to do so. We will be cutting the open house short in order to accommodate the formal public comment period. So I also just want to say our next meeting, which is on May 3rd, we will be specifically discussing streams and fish and habitat conservation areas. So you're welcome to retain your public comment until that evening if your comment is related to that topic. Our meeting to discuss wetlands, wetland management areas, lake management districts, that will be on May 17th. So during those two meetings, we will actually have an opportunity to ask questions and be very clear about what areas we would like to request some additional information from the consultant or staff, this specifically for commissioners in, as input into our deliberation. We will also be determining which of the recommendations we would like to proceed to a more formal consideration. So of the recommendations you've seen tonight, we have not made any decision or had any dialogue about which of those recommendations we want to actually progress to further consideration. So on that note, the other thing I'll point out is we've been here for a couple of hours, and so if you need to excuse yourself politely and quietly due to the amount of time you've been sitting in your chair, you're welcome to do that, but we won't take a formal break. Sorry.
Can
so
we stay later and take a break? I mean, I would personally rather stay to 9:30, have everyone make their public comment, have a little bit of open house, stay to 9:30, and have a little break.
So we, well,
anyone?
If you're the only one that needs a break, take a break real quick and come back is what I would suggest.
I think the more important thing is to stay late.
And let's see how long the public comment takes. And commissioners, we will take a check on 9 o'clock and determine if we would like to keep the open house later than that officially. Yes, Mr. Commissioner Collins.
Are you saying that you do public comment now, then open house, then public comment?
We're doing public comment now. Then we will do open house. We will not have public comment tonight after the open house, but we may choose to keep the open house open later because of the extended public comment. Is that clear to everybody? Okay. Okay, great. So the first person I have on the list, and I believe I'm going in order, and I apologize if I am not, is Mr. McGraw. And Commissioner Wasserman, would you do me a favor? Would you see if the timer is over there? Thank you.
I'm Jim McGraw. I'm going to try to keep it really short.
Super. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Anyhow, Jim McGraw, you can be reached. I'm a resident of Sammamish. I can be reached at towrunner.org. I just brought in, because it was wetlands and stream, I brought in my 2009, whatever it was, mailing for... It's 2010, January 2010, Beaver Lake, telling you, showing that the standards that they set prior to the new standards that we now have with setbacks worked very well for Beaver Lake, not just for phosphorus, but for everything, overall improving, and so that the new standards haven't improved anything. So there's the best available science that I can come up with. I also... had an objection to what, just because people may not agree with the city staff or the city or whatever, and there may be a conflict between property rights and what the city deems to be their role, I don't think they should reiterate that that person may be just colorful, or that situation is a very colorful, long history. I think... everybody in the city deserves respect. So I think I would, you know, because there are people up here whose lives have been devastated and they feel upset, and then to have them do that. Another thing is really interesting, Duncan's, presentation said 5 to 10 feet basically had most of the improvement for the setbacks. Everything else was, you know, there's a law of diminishing returns. You look at that chart. Another thing is that they like to prominently display King County on those charts. Well, King County has a different function than the city. King County is outside of the urban growth area. You're inside the urban growth area. They're trying to maximize no development, and we're supposed to accept development in the population. And so you're putting them into the chart is not... a good idea. And then in a public comment, I'll try to just finish up, and I could go on for hours, right? But public comment 29, they talked about the Beaver Lake Management District. They can go to the, and they said, well, the phosphorus, well, it's much more than just the phosphorus. And the phosphorus, the best thing for the phosphorus would be to cut down all the trees because the leaves cause the phosphorus in the lakes. But I'm not going to propose that. So, but if you're anybody, it's a January 2010, volume 10, issue 2. You go right to the back page of the summary. You can read the whole thing. and it's the best available science. It isn't based some far away.
Wonderful. Thanks. Thank you, Mr. McGraw. The person I have next on the list is Jeffrey Creighton. Mr. Creighton was a maybe. Is that a? Great. Thank you very much. The next person I have is he's already spoken. Oh boy, this one's going to be hard for me. Mr. starts with an M. Majevjik. Thank you. Yes, you're welcome to speak next time. Thank you very much. The next person I have is he's already spoken. Mr. Smith, Mr. Craig Smith. Is Mr. Smith present?
He seated his time before now.
Oh, thank you. I didn't catch that. Thank you very much. I am not calling on people that spoke previously in the interest of fairness. So then I have Mr. Kipp.
I'll speak next time.
Great. Mr. Kipp has ceded his time to a future meeting. And I now have Mr. Osgood.
Great. Thank you. Jim Osgood, 19661 Southeast 24th Way in Sammamish. I'm here to basically talk about isolated wetlands and the definition of what a small isolated wetland is. I went through all the documents that were cited in the consultant's report, and I found nowhere any mention of any sizes of what a small, isolated wetland is. And I think that's a really important factor in your being able to determine which of those should be evaluated or what should the exemption be. I am a little curious as to why Bellevue, Issaquah, and King County have different science than the city of Sammamish in terms of their defining an isolated wetland as 2,500 square feet or less. In fact, those 2,500 square feet or less, according to the consultant's report, are not even considered critical areas. So I think that's something that you need to take a really hard look at, and I'd like to find out what the science behind the 1,000 square feet as an isolated wetland is. So that's my comment for tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Osgood. I have Ms. Richardson next. Wonderful. She ceded her time to a future meeting. Ms. Eastlick.
Linda Eastlick, P.O. Box 2574, Issaquah. And I'm reading into the record George Toskey's comments. Okay. He says, buffers. I'm not good at French, but la solution toujours pour tout. The best available science reports prepared by the consultants present numerous documents describing the buffer widths that are required to protect wetlands and streams. The missing information is what these buffers are protecting the wetlands and streams from. The scientific method would first identify the problems and then propose and test solutions to the problems. What we see in the BAS reports is one solution, buffers, applied to all of the potential problems that are not even identified. Further, the reports contain generalized statements like the following that exaggerate the impact of the Sammamish ECA regulations. This statement is about Lake Sammamish. The lake's surface water temperature, nutrient and pollutant loading, and sediment and organic debris inputs are all affected by Sammamish's regulations protecting wetlands, streams, and riparian buffers. Firstly, the surface water temperature is overwhelmingly controlled by the temperature of the air and the heat from the sun. The temperature of the water from Sammamish streams has no measurable impact on the surface temperature of Lake Sammamish. Secondly, how does building a house on one's property near a stream cause nutrient and pollutant loading? What is the source of the nutrients and pollutants? A structure actually blocks phosphorus and other nutrients in the soil from reaching the wetlands and streams. Thirdly, are buffers the best solution for keeping sediment and organic debris from entering wetlands and streams and eventually Lake Sammamish? Wouldn't bank stabilization techniques between a house and a stream provide better protection? Buffers offer nothing to control the spread of sediment and organic debris. They're just there. We heard some reporting to the contrary, but that's what's here. Buffers of mandated width, irrespective of circumstance, are easy to cast into regulations and easy to enforce. However, effective regulations should reflect the intended results and proven ways to achieve them, not a convenient fix that may or may not address the issues. Doesn't the environment deserve the best protections available rather than one convenient fix for all of the issues? And my apologies for my own editorializing there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Eastlick. Next on the list is Mr. Brockway.
Thank you. Reed Brockway, 167 East Lake Sammamish Shore Lane, Northeast. Did something like that the last time, too. Okay, I have a jump drive here with a PowerPoint presentation.
Just while we're waiting, after Mr. Brockway, we have Ms. Brockway, and that will conclude our signed-up list.
I want to delete stuff that you want to leave on here. Where do I find my device?
I'm guessing it's down over there.
Oh, it showed up already.
I don't have any ready.
Yep.
Great.
Keep losing the arrow. Man, that arrow's fast. Okay. sorry about that. I'm an engineer too. I'm supposed to be able to do this kind of stuff. First of all, I want to say I really appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight. I was really getting uptight with the prospect of not being able to, because frankly, what I have to provide by way of input is important to the deliberations you're going to be doing in the next couple of weeks, at least if I interpret the schedule correctly. On the 3rd, that's when the initial Planning Commission recommendations are supposed to be out, and this is input to that process. So to have to wait until then was not a very comfortable prospect. Now, I'm part of the Citizens for Sammamish Environment subgroup, as I think most of you know, and my particular area of specialization is streams for that group. I have written testimony that I've submitted that's a compilation of a number of significant problems that I feel exist with the streams code. But tonight I want to focus on one particular a set of charts that captures what I'd call a main essence of the problem. I submitted both of these to the Planning Commission today, and when Evan did not indicate that he had received them, that's when I got uptight and did a me sort of situation. I wanted to make sure that you got them, and apparently Debbie's absence means that they haven't found their way to you. I sure hope they do in a fairly short period of time. It's important that I do this presentation, though, because you need the words to go with the music here, or it's not going to make convey the message properly. One other thing, my presentation takes a little over 7 minutes, and my wife signed up as well and has ceded her time to me, and I think in the interest of continuity, it's best if I do the whole thing. No sense changing horses in the middle of a stream buffer. And I invite you to ask questions during this if you'd care to. Now, page down. Works. Okay. There are two main problems, as I see it, with the stream code. One is that the current code inappropriately applies forest practices to urban settings. And the other is that it does not adequately distinguish between new developments and established neighborhoods. And I want to point out that there are reasonable solutions to these, and I'll get to them later in my presentation. This is perhaps a little different perspective than what you've been hearing tonight. I think it's important that you hear this side of the story. This next chart I think it was pretty much covered by the consultant. I might point out, though, that down next to the bottom it says there are no flow rate qualifications on any of these stream types. It doesn't take much to be a type F stream. The state standards define streams as having more than 20 cubic foot per second flow, and there's no such qualification in our code. Okay, now I could speak at length about the subject of forest practices, but the city's provided us with a reference that's containing a statement that captures the essence of this issue as I see it, and it's in the document Department of Commerce GMA update, which is found in the resource guide section on the county webpage under tab 1, and it has a section addressing stream typing where it says, and I quote, "The modeling system used to assess stream types was designed to address higher elevation forested areas and not low-lying urbanized areas." Our consultant's report on streams has some statements that imply this as well, I believe. So there seems to be a generally accepted concept for what constitutes a stream buffer. It fits a forest or rural setting. And here's a typical representation. There are a lot of these out on the internet. But this, you'll notice, shows the land sloping down into the stream. There's substantially forested areas on both sides of the stream. And then this shows perhaps a rural setting because on one side it shows maybe cropland and the other side pasture. But in fact, it could be lumbering, or I should say timber harvesting on the other side of it too. This could be off in a wilderness somewhere. And you'll note that the buffers here add up to 95 feet. That's compared with our 150 feet on a type F stream. Now, you put this into an urban setting, and you have a radically different situation. This is kind of a crude diagram, but it basically shows a community of houses right next to each other on 75-foot lots, those little hash marks there. Can you see my arrow? Oh, there now I can. These little hash marks are at 75-foot distances. And here's a little type F stream that's meandering through the middle of this neighborhood. You notice with our buffers now, we have 150 feet on either side, which basically cuts a 300-foot swath through that neighborhood of restricted land use. And then in addition to that, you have a 15-foot setback outside of that where you're not allowed to erect any structures like a garden shed or any thing of the sort. So it's a whole different situation than what you would experience in a forest setting. And here's a real example from our community. This is one of our neighborhoods, and it has a little type F stream running through the middle. This dark line in the middle is that. I'm having a hard time seeing my arrow. At any rate, the dark objects are houses or garages, and down at the base here you have a road. What have I done with my arrow? Well, oh, there it is, finally. Bifocals are not the world's greatest devices. This is paving, an access road, and paving in front of driveways and such. So the vegetated areas, if you will, are these other patches. And you can see from this that what somebody does in his yard over here is going to have minimal, if any, effect on this stream. Similarly, over here, and certainly not this property, but in fact, 150-foot buffers creates this dotted line you see on either side over here. So this little creek affects four adjacent properties or more. So why is this a problem? Well, as the code now stands, these property owners are required to obtain a permit to do any landscaping beyond simple maintenance. And maintenance is defined as things like, defined and interpreted by staff, mowing of lawns, pruning, bringing in beauty bark, and that sort of thing. And the footprints of these structures can't be expanded, so that has the effect of reducing property values. And no new structures are permitted in the area within the 165-foot distance from the creek. In such situations, one-size-fits-all buffers by stream type definitely simplify and the code, make it easier to administer, but they bear no particular relation to the actual width of habitat or range of influence on that stream, and they arbitrarily burden the developed properties. Now, how is this a problem? I have here a little fictional conversation between a resident of Sammamish and a staff person who deals with permit applications. And this is based, it's consistent with the ECA code as it now exists, and it's also consistent with the experience some people have had with the city in similar situations. Ahem. Citizen, hello, I'm a resident of the city and I have a small landscaping project. I want to replace a small diseased tree and move a garden over garden wall over a few feet. My neighbor says I need a permit to do that. Is that true? Staff, it depends. What's the diameter of the tree near the base? Citizen, about 4 inches. Staff, that would not normally require a permit, but what's your address? Citizen gives his address. Staff, let's see, and he looks it up. Well, our overlay map shows that your property is within a stream buffer, and you're only allowed to plant native vegetation in a stream buffer. Citizen, but that little creek doesn't have any fish in it. And besides, there's another house and driveway between my yard and the creek. What I want to do won't affect that creek at all. Staff, that may be, but the creek is classified as a type F stream, meaning it could potentially have salmonids in it. And a type F stream has a 150-foot buffer on either side in which only native vegetation may be planted. What kind of tree do you want to plant? Citizen, a madrona. Staff, I'm sorry, but that's not on the list of approved native species allowed in a stream buffer. Citizen, well, what about moving my wall? Staff, well, normally that kind of activity is not allowed in a stream buffer, but you can apply for a clearing and grading permit and we will review it. Citizen, and what about the tree? I assume I can replace the diseased one with the same kind or plant another kind from your list, right? Staff, yes, but you'll need to submit a restoration or enhancement plan and we'll review that. Citizen, and is that plan likely to be approved? Staff, I can't say, but I'd advise you to hire a licensed wetland biologist to prepare the plan. Citizen, and what will that cost me? Staff, I can't tell you that. Well, can you give me an idea of what it has cost other people doing this kind of thing? Staff, $1,000 or $2,000. Citizen, this is not reasonable. All I want to do is replace a tree and move a little wall. The plan you want is going to cost me 10 times what that will cost. Staff, I'm sorry, but that's the code, and we all have to adhere to it. Citizen, I've been living here and maintaining my property for over 20 years. Aren't I grandfathered in for this kind of thing? Staff, there are provisions in the code, specifically Chapter 21A70, which address non-conforming uses and non-conforming site improvements. I believe landscaping and a stream buffer falls under that. As long as it was done legally when it was put in, you can maintain it. You can also modify it, as long as you don't expand the degree of non-conformance. But here again, you need to submit a plan to our department that makes the case and we'll review it. Citizen, $1,000 or $2,000, right? Staff, I imagine so, plus our fee. Citizen, this is unreasonable. These are things any ordinary property owner would be allowed to do. It's entirely within their rights and should be within mine. The fact that there's a creek two lots away that my little project won't affect whatsoever shouldn't mean that I'm subjected to this hassle and expense. Staff, silence. They've heard it before. Citizen, okay, is there somebody else I can talk to about this? Staff, no. Citizen, isn't there an ombudsman? Staff, no. Is there nothing I can do? Staff, you can hire an attorney. That's the end of the little dramatization, but please understand this is not intended to be an indictment of staff. Staff has to work within the framework of the city's codes and procedures as they exist, but it is real. I've seen this kind of thing happen. A big issue this involves is that of property rights. And here again, on the webpage, there's RCW 3678, Growth Management Planning by Selected Counties and Cities, that has a subsection in it on property rights that states, the property rights of landowners shall be protected from arbitrary and discriminatory actions. The dramatization I just gave you really is an example of both. It's arbitrary because it's imposing a buffer where there may be no environmental benefit from one. And it's discriminatory because it prevents or inhibits a subset of residents from doing something most residents have a clear, unrestricted right to do. Now, solutions. I said I'd get to solutions, and I'm almost done. Thanks for sticking with me here. Ideally, there are a lot of magic numbers in the code, like 150-foot buffers, which we haven't seen the science for, but they're in there, and they should be assessed, both for the science behind them and the law behind them. And they should be replaced by problem and solution-driven requirements that get at what you're trying to accomplish with the buffer, not just an arbitrary number. And George's testimony, George Tusky, touched on that as well. But there is a simpler compromise solution, and that's to add the option of buffer delineation. This is also referred in some circles as prescriptive buffers. Rather than a single specified width, what you do with buffer delineation is determine the actual range of influence around an urban stream or other water course, and you take into account topography, whether the land is sloping away from or towards the stream, and the band of viable habitat that actually exists there. This approach recognizes that features like roads, buildings, and walls can constitute de facto boundaries to buffers. It solves the inequities of the one-size-fits-all buffers, and it applies to other ECAs as well. Wetlands, for example, and wildlife conservation areas can benefit from this. It's supported by an abundance of best available science, and other jurisdictions do this. So my recommendation is that Sammamish should perform buffer delineation either upon specific request from some entity or for the entire city as part of an overlay scheme. But I recognize that resources may not allow that. So in that case, citizens and developers should at least be given the option to having this done at their own expense by qualified professionals that the city accepts. And I can supply you a draft text for such a clause. Final chart. As I mentioned, I submitted additional testimony, and I'd really encourage you to see that as soon as it becomes available to you, because it addresses a wider range of issues. I'd be happy to provide specific recommended code changes to deal with some of this, but the absence of science and law for the details in the code as it stands right now, because the consultant really is not getting down to that level, really makes this task significantly more difficult than it ought to be. Finally, I'd welcome any additional discussion with you folks about this at any time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brockway. For the record, I'd like to state a policy for ceding time to other speakers. I do not want to cede more than one person's time so that we have a maximum of 14 minutes per speaker. I think that that's a reasonable amount of time to make a presentation, and I want to make sure that we set a precedent. So thank you, Mr. Brockway, for your presentation, and appreciate the fact that you did have someone cede their time, but I do want to make sure that going forward we handle those things in a consistent manner. So thank you. That concludes everyone that has signed up for public comment. I want to just briefly offer the opportunity for anyone that has not signed up. Please raise your hand. Seeing none, I will close the public comment for today. I also am going to close the formal recording of today's session. We will take a 5-minute break, or you know, as long as it takes to reorganize the room for an open house. We'll do a time check at 9 o'clock to see if there's still discussion that is continuing and determine whether or not we want to call the meeting officially closed at 9 or if we want to extend it at that point in time. So thank you very much.